Bibles with me to the Gospel of Luke in chapter 5. The Gospel record of Luke at chapter number 5, verses 1 through verse number 11. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will. Thank you. You may be seated. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand forever. If you're writing, if you're marking in your Bible or on your pad, underline that word. At your word, I will. That's what I want to preach about this morning. At your word, I will. I don't have to understand it. I don't have to like it. But if it's your word, I will. Have you ever done something that you didn't want to do? I hear people all the time, people in my family, friends of mine, who say that they don't know what they would do in retirement. They don't want to retire. They just can't see themselves retiring. And my answer to them is always the same. I never want to work in the first place. I can't wait to retire. I don't like working. On your job, you've been given assignments that you didn't like doing. In your home, growing up as a child, or as a husband or a wife, as a brother or a sister, you've been assigned things to do that you just didn't want to do. And even though you may not have wanted to do it, you did it anyway. You did it perhaps out of a sense of obligation. Or you did it out of a sense of duty. Or you did it because you feared consequences. But no matter the reason, you did what you were asked to do, perhaps out of respect for the person who was asking you to do it. No matter what the reason, all of us at some time in our lives have been called upon to do what we don't want to do. This is just the scene that presents itself in these verses this morning. Simon Peter is called upon to do something that he just does not want to do. In Luke chapter 5, verse number 11, Jesus calls to Peter to follow him, and that call eclipses the call of the sons of Zebedee, James and John. It eclipses even the call of Andrew, who is responsible for Simon Peter even coming to Jesus in the first place. Because usually when Jesus calls us, he calls us to do what perhaps we think we can't do, and if we can, we don't want to do it. Something like the epic call of Moses. In the book of Exodus, he calls Moses to do what Moses thinks he is not qualified to do. In Isaiah chapter 6, he calls Isaiah to do what Isaiah thinks he's unworthy to do. In Acts chapter 9, he calls Paul, whose name was Saul, out of his life of persecuting the church. And each one of them, including Peter, does not believe that they are worthy of the calling, but God does not call the equipped. He equips the called. Let me run that by you one more time. God does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called. Even if you don't want to do it. Even if it's something you think you are not up to doing, or you think you're unworthy to do, if it's his word, your response ought to be, I will. Walk with me around the text. Jesus' reputation has spread far and wide. He's already healed Peter's mother-in-law of a fever. He's gone into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and demonstrated in their presence that the word that he just read from the prophecy of Isaiah has been fulfilled in their hearing. He's come to preach the gospel to the poor, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. He reads that scripture, and then he gives the book back to the attendant in the temple, and he says, this scripture now is fulfilled in your hearing. He has healed the sick. He has demonstrated that he is the Son of God, and his reputation has spread, and now throngs of people, multitudes of people, are coming out to hear him. Jesus is on the Lake of Gennesaret. The other synoptics call it the Sea of Galilee, but Luke calls it the Lake of Gennesaret. And the crowds, thousands of them, have come to hear Jesus preach the word of God. Now, when you read the Gospel of Luke, only Jesus preaches the word of God. Can you imagine hearing Jesus preach? I wish I had time to stay right there. But read it when you get home. In the Gospel of Luke, every time the word of God is mentioned, Jesus is preaching. The apostles preach in the book of Acts and the rest of the New Testament. But every time Luke mentions the word of God, it is coming directly from Jesus Christ. And they want to hear him so badly that thousands of them come to the Lake of Gennesaret. Jesus gets in a boat, and as is the custom in the Greco-Roman world, in the Jewish world, the teacher, the rabbi sits down. He reclines to teach them. But there are so many people in the crowd that he gets into a boat, and he pushes out a little from the land, and the waves from the Lake of Gennesaret act as an acoustic loudspeaker and carry his voice to the thousands of people who are in this natural amphitheater at the Lake of Gennesaret. And he preaches to them the word of God. As good as this choir sang this morning, you didn't come here to hear singing. As spirited as the devotional time was, as moving as the prayer time was, the only reason, hopefully, you got up this morning is to hear the word of God. Because there is power in the word. I wish I had one or two more witnesses here. If you don't believe the word has power, when your soul is distressed,
When your spirit is out of sorts, just open the word of God and read where he says weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. That will set your soul on fire. When your enemies think they have you trapped, open the word of God and read him saying, fret not yourself because of evildoers, neither be envious against the workers of iniquity. They shall soon be cut off like grass. I wish I had somebody to help me. Some people say when they read the Bible, it makes them sleepy. When I read the Bible, it wakes me up. Because the word is alive. It's active. It's powerful. It's dynamic. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. Jesus himself preaches the word of God. And then the Bible says when he gets through teaching, he says to Peter, who's the owner of the boat, launch out into the deep. Go a little further into the deep. Now, the early church, which was fond of allegory, allegorizes verse number 4. Look at verse number 4. And now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. The early church allegorized just about everything in the Bible. And they saw in verse 4 a command to forsake the safe harbor and launch out into the deep where there is no safety except the word of God. Somebody ought to help me preach right here. Launch out into the deep. Get out of safe waters and go to a place where the only help you can find is the word of God. I wish I had one or two more witnesses here. Get out of the safety of this sanctuary. Get out of the safety of your comfortable environment and trust God for something only God can do. The reason why you may not be accomplishing much is because you're trying to play it too safe. But our God is a big God. God is an awesome God. The psalmist says, they that go down to the sea in ships, that do business in great waters, these see the works of the Lord and his wonders in the deep. It's safe near the land. It's comfortable near the land. But Jesus said, launch out into the deep where your only hope is my word. Lilly Grove, the Holy Ghost is speaking to us this morning. Let's stop worrying about this building. And stop worrying about these windows. And stop worrying about who's tithing and who's not tithing and who's giving and who's not giving. This is the Lord's church. And God knows how he wants to populate his church. God will send to his church whoever he wants to send to his church. And God will use whoever he wants to use to build up the kingdom through his church. Let's quit worrying about what we are doing and trust God to do what he is doing. Stop asking God to bless what we are doing and let's learn how to do what God is blessing. I wish I had time to stay right there. When you look at verse 5 talks to us about a night of struggle. Jesus said, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. But in verse 5, Peter tells Jesus, Simon tells Jesus, Master, we have toiled all night. We have worked our fingers to the bone. We are expert fishermen. The fish are biting at night. In the morning, when the sun is out, they can see the net. They go deeper in the water in the morning. They come up to the top at night. We've worked all night. We know what we're doing. We are expert fishermen. You just a carpenter.
Brothers and sisters, Jesus begins Peter's journey of discipleship not by calling him away from his profession, but by challenging him to a bolder practice of his profession.
I know what you are. I'm trying to make you better at it. I don't want you to stop doing what you're doing. I'm trying to teach you how to do it better.
I don't want to take you out the classroom. I want to make you a Christian teacher.
I don't want to take you out the office. I want to make you a saved co-worker.
Somebody ought to help me talk it.
I'm not trying to take you off your job. I'm trying to make you better at what your job is. I'm trying to anoint you in your profession.
Oh, brothers and sisters, thank God for school teachers. But hallelujah for a saved school teacher. Thank God for a lawyer. But hallelujah for a saved lawyer. Thank God for a politician. But thank God for a saved politician.
God is not trying to take you off your job. He's trying to make your job sweeter.
Sometimes when God is getting more of us, we mistake that for a call to preach. God ain't calling you to preach. He's calling you to preach through your job. Preach through your life. Preach through your profession.
Be anointed in what you do. He's not trying to take you off your job. He's trying to make your job sweeter.
And hear me. Hear me, brothers and sisters. Jesus does not assert his lordship over Simon in the area of his weakness. He asserts his lordship in the area of his strength.
Listen.
How many of you in here, by a show of hands, how many of you go fishing? Raise your hand. Let me see it. Raise it high. If you really know how to fish. I mean, you caught a fish once or twice. Yeah, raise it high. Don't fool me now. If you ain't caught no fish, don't lie to me. Because a lot of us, like myself, fish at the fish market. I fish in the seafood section at Fiesta. I don't know the first thing about fishing. You're gonna help me preach this, won't you?
But I do understand that nothing puts a real fisherman in a foul mood quicker than when a non-fisherman orders him to do again in a bad situation what he failed to do in a good situation. In verse 5, Peter said, Lord, we tried all night. We know where the fish are. We know what kind of nets to use. We know what kind of lures and floats to use. We do this every day for a livelihood.
Nevertheless, at your word, I will. I ain't with it, but you the master. I'm gonna do what you say. I already know how this is gonna turn out. But at your word, I will. Now, brothers and sisters, I don't know if it is foreknowledge or willpower that made those fish come. I don't know if Jesus knew they were going to be there or if Jesus made them come. No matter, they were amazed. Because I think it's a nature miracle. It's a gift that Jesus is saying to them, I know you think you know. But you can't possibly know like I know. You think you fishing. I don't want you to fish. I want you to follow. I wish I had somebody to help me. I'm not really calling you to fish. I'm calling you to follow. And if you follow, the fish gonna show up. Is there anybody here who didn't know how things were gonna turn out? But you trusted God in spite of overwhelming evidence to the contrary? I wish I had a real shouter right here. I hear people say all the time, if your heart is not in it, don't do it. But that's bad advice. Just do what the word of God says to do, even when your heart is not in it, because your heart will soon follow where your mind leads it. Has there anybody here ever come to church and didn't feel like praising God, but then God moved in your spirit and reminded you of where he brought you from? And in spite of what you don't have, you thank him for what you have left. And even though you didn't feel like giving God any praise, your heart followed your action. There are two voices that's audible in Peter's reply. The first voice is the voice of a fisherman. We toiled all night and we haven't caught anything. That's the fisherman talking. That's Peter, the fisherman. But then Peter, the faithful, speaks up. He says, nevertheless. And every Christian here this morning needs to come to the point in your faith when your testimony is nevertheless. I don't understand it. I don't know how you're going to work it out. I don't know how you're going to bring it to pass. I can't see it. I can't understand it. But listen, I don't have to see it. I don't have to know why. I just need to know who. And if I know who, the why can come later on. Listen, I dare you. I put a stick on my shoulder. And I dare you, I double dare you to just trust God when you can't see where he's taking you. And you watch God open doors that will close in your face. Somebody here got a testimony that they tried to block you on your job, but God just kept promoting you. Members of your own family never thought you'd be where you are right now. But look how far the Lord has brought you.
people you're sitting in the pews with have lied on you and talked bad about you behind your back, but you're still smiling. You're still giving God praise. And they're wondering, why are you still happy? All the stuff I've sent to pull you down. God will keep you. He'll prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemy.
Nevertheless, if it's your word, I will. And they move, brothers and sisters, from a night of struggle to a morning of surrender. Because when you read the succeeding verses, and when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net break. And they beckoned unto their partners which should come to help them, and they came and filled both the ships, so that both of the ships began to sink. Both of the ships begin to sink. They toiled all night and caught nothing. But now morning comes and they surrender to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And they've got so many fish that their nets are breaking. I want to help somebody shout right here. When you trust God, in spite of evidence to the contrary, He'll make your nets break. Some of y'all are awfully quiet in here this morning. That's because you've been trusting in your good looks. You've been trusting in your college degree. You've been trusting in your street smarts. You've been trusting in your sophistication and your wits. But I dare you to just put all your trust in God and say, God, I don't know how you're working this out, but I'm in your hand. God, make my net break. Well, maybe I'd get a shout if I asked this question. How many of you want more fish than you can put in your net? Then trust God. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path. I'm looking at some people here whose nets are breaking, because you just trusted God when people told you you were crazy. You say, you out your mind? You ain't feeling good? Why are you going to church this morning? If you don't take care of yourself, nobody else will. You working on a job, and they making you train somebody else for your job. But the same God you trusted last year will let you stay on the job this year. Somebody ought to have a testimony here. That the doctor said, I can't do anything else for you. But here you are this morning, because you were just foolish enough to say, at your word, I will. I will what? I will bless the Lord at all times. I will lift my hands in the sanctuary. I will open my mouth with the sacrifice of praise. I will tell my testimony everywhere I go. I will shout unto the Lord with the voice of triumph. I will give God my best hallelujah. I will raise a loud anthem to His goodness. I will speak aloud of His mercy.
I will tell everybody about his kindness. I will. I will. It gets hard sometimes, but I will. It gets dark sometimes, but I will.
After a night of struggle, after a morning of surrender, comes a tomorrow of satisfaction. It's right here in the text. When the net started breaking, Jesus, who has not mentioned sin yet, Peter looks at him with new eyes. And he says, "Depart from me, O Lord, because I am a sinful man." Jesus didn't even mention sin. But when you in the presence of a holy God, you can't help but see yourself as you really are. I wish I had somebody to help me. Moses said, "Who am I to go to Pharaoh? Send my brother Aaron. He's more eloquent of speech." Moses stuttered and stammered when he spoke. He said, "God, I can't go. Send my brother." God said, just open your mouth and I will speak for you. You're going to help me preach this, won't you? Then Moses decided to go. He said, "Now, Lord, I'm going. But when I get there, they're going to ask me who sent me. And what is his name?" I wish I had a Bible reader. The Lord said, "Tell him I am that I am." I wish I had somebody to help me preach. Isaiah said it was in the year that King Uzziah died that I saw also the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Seraphim had six wings. With two wings, they covered their face. With two wings, they covered their feet. With two wings, they did fly. And the house was filled with smoke. And the doorposts moved at the voice of him that cried. You're going to help me preach this, won't you? He said, "Then I saw the seraphim with a live coal touch my lips with a coal from off the altar." I wish I had one or two more witnesses. He said, "This has touched your lips. Your sins are forgiven. Your iniquity is purged." And then after the Lord cleaned him up, Isaiah heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" Then Isaiah said, "Here am I. Send me." Is there anybody here was scared when the Lord spoke to you, but then the Lord emboldened you and gave you the power to do in the Holy Spirit what you thought you couldn't do by yourself? And here you are in this sanctuary this morning. You're not all that you ought to be, but you thank God you're not what you used to be. Is there anybody here? No, you're still a sinner, but God is still using you. You're still a crook, but God still got his hands on you. You're still a liar, but God is getting glory out of you. You still low down sometime, but God is still getting praise out of you. Is there anybody here
No God can hit a straight line with a crooked stick. Is there anybody here? Know that we have this treasure in an earthen vessel, that the excellency of the power might be of God and not of us. We are persecuted on every side. I wish I had one or two witnesses. If the Lord's been good to you, in spite of your wicked ways, thank God for your night of struggle. Thank God for your morning of surrender. But praise God for your tomorrow of satisfaction. Thank God he can still use you in spite of the holes in your testimony. He can still get glory out of you in spite of the mess you got yourself in. Is there anybody here? No, God can use you when you acknowledge how good he is and how no good you are. Why don't you grab somebody? Why don't you shake somebody's hand? Tell them God's been good to me. Come on, tell them like you mean it. God has opened doors for me. And if God gives me a chance, I'm going to praise his name. I'm going to shout hallelujah. I'm going to give him the glory. Why don't you hug somebody? I'm talking about a real shouter now. Don't fool around with just anybody. Don't be hanging around with just anybody. Grab somebody who's been through the storm and the rain. Find somebody who know God can answer prayer. Find somebody who the Lord has made a way for. And why don't you right now tell God at your word, I will. At your word, I will. I will bless the Lord. I will shout hallelujah. I will come to church Sunday morning. I will speak aloud of your goodness. Why don't you grab somebody? Tell them how good God's been. Tell them how many ways God has made for you. How many doors God has opened for you. You don't need nobody now. Just look in the rearview mirror. Just look back over 2015. It was a rough year for somebody. But God brought you out. God made a way. Come on, help me praise him. Help me lift him up. Shout if you want to. Praise him if you feel like it. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? I know he's all right. At your word, I will. And they caught so many fish that their nets break. They called some more ships. And not only were their nets breaking too, but their ship started sinking. And Peter looked at Jesus and said, I'm not even worthy to be in your presence. Depart from me, O Lord, for I am a sinful man. And the scripture says, Jesus said to Peter, fear not. This is the sermon right here. All this other stuff I said ain't nothing. This is the sermon right here. Jesus said, fear not. From now on, you won't be catching fish, but you'll be catching men. Because you catch fish for them to die. You catch men for them to live.